Hello and welcome back to the Digital Health and Wearables series. Today I have another magnificent episode for you with great content, but before I go ahead, let me ask you to check out all the previous content, great stuff there for you. Make sure you subscribe to the channel and share with your communities in healthcare, and also check out our partners and sponsors. Today I'm truly excited. We have Ogan Gurel with us. Very special episode for you. Is the Chief Science Officer for FLITE Material Sciences Corporation. He's also the founder of the MiniMD, an innovation leader, author, and speaker. Ogan, how are you?
Good, thanks. Good afternoon to you. It's good morning here in Montreal. Great to be on your show or your program.
Yeah, it's nice to have you here. Also, like in general terms, we are discussing the healthcare paradigm, but we have many, many things to discuss. And you have a very diverse career from medicine to science to academia to business. Can you give us a brief overview and your philosophy around your work, please?
Well, thanks again. I'm a medical doctor by training. I did my medical degree at Columbia in New York City, but I also have a science background. I worked in biochemistry, molecular biophysics. Martin Karplus, who got the Nobel Prize in 2013, was my thesis advisor at Harvard. So I've been deeply in the scientific world and collaborating worldwide. And then also on the business side and the investment side and consulting, and then of course academia, teaching innovation. So it's been pretty diverse. And I think one of the benefits of that is that I tend to look at the big picture of things. And obviously digital healthcare impacts across all areas of healthcare. And so it gives me this background, diverse as it is, gives me a perspective that can look at the big picture and also a little bit out of the box. I don't get focused onto one particular area. And finally, what ties everything together is I love innovation. And so if there's a common theme to this diverse career, it's an innovation generally and healthcare innovation specifically.
Oh, brilliant. So fantastic. You certainly have an amazing CV, if you like. So delighted to have you here. Thank you so much for accepting the invitation. Also, I've been following your great work around the world. You've been speaking on innovation, on healthcare, on other subjects as well. So we're going to go straight to the questions. Are you okay with that?
Yeah, of course.
So the first question that I have for you, Ogan, is what do you think is missing in healthcare right now?
Well, there's a lot of talk, you know, whenever you're a venture capitalist or an entrepreneur, you talk about unmet needs. That's the kind of buzzword, and that's very important. There are unmet needs in all sorts of diseases, and unmet needs in terms of, so unmet needs is a very important thing. But I think one of the biggest unmet needs, again, talking about this broad view, is a certain level of health literacy on the part of patients and people. Now, why do I say that? So digital healthcare, if you think about it, goes by a number of things like patient-oriented healthcare, consumer-directed healthcare, decentralized healthcare, personalized medicine, medicine and healthcare at home, all these sorts of trends, but they can all boil down to one common theme, and that is empowering the patient. So you have all sorts of wearables, you have all sorts of AI, you have all these wonderful technologies that are empowering the patient. But if you sit back and look at the big picture and say, well, if the patient doesn't have a basic knowledge about healthcare and the body and illness and health and wellness, if the basic healthcare knowledge is not there, like we are supposed to learn in health education in junior high school, and throughout our lives, all of those technologies are going to be limited in their impact. So I think that the biggest thing missing in healthcare is a very strong, I don't mean that everyone has to be like a medical doctor, but a very strong fundamental basic knowledge of wellness and health among people. Now, you might say, well, that's not really that important. But if we look at the misinformation issue out there, you know, anti-vaxxers and all this misinformation, and to be honest, even the experts giving conflicting views, the CDC in the United States changing, you know, their views, people can't make sense of it. They don't have knowledge. And then you get all sorts of really terrible outcomes. So not just on the individual level, but on a societal level, the biggest unmet need in healthcare right now is somehow to expand and improve the health literacy of everybody.
Oh, that's fantastic. You know, I've been in healthcare for over 20 years personally, but I was in corporate wellness for a number of years. And I realized I'm not a clinician or a doctor, or not a medical person, but I realized very, very quickly that the missing link is always the educational side, educating people about our nutrition or about health behavior. And it's very, very important in healthcare. Thank you so much for that amazing overview. And the second question that I have for you is, can you share what is important in digital healthcare going forward?
Yes. So in addition to the education component, which I think is absolutely critical, I think one of the other important aspects of digital healthcare, again, thinking broadly, is that it is actually changing the way medicine is being practiced. In other words, it's changing the paradigms of medicine. Now, you might say there are some obvious ways, for example, telemedicine. You don't, you know, walk to the doctor's office, you see them on a screen, various forms of diagnosis aided by AI and so on and so forth. Those are, in a sense, the obvious paradigm shifts. But what I'm talking about is the fundamental paradigm shifts. And you mentioned the MiniMD. I teach the MiniMD, which is a comprehensive overview of all of medicine for healthcare professionals. And that's kind of the current paradigm. But that paradigm is changing. So I'll give a couple examples how digital healthcare is changing the paradigm of healthcare. One is the blurring of the line between wellness and medical. Now, you might say that's obvious, but if you look at the society and the regulations, insurance and government payment, and the structure of the healthcare system, it's predicated on a very sharp divide. I know this because I was at Samsung for 4.5 years when I was in South Korea, and there's a big debate at the highest levels, you know, should we go into wellness? Should we go into medical? And that decision, which is the same decisions that Google and Apple and all those were making, means, you know, do we go into the whole area of liability and regulation, or do we stand back and do more wellness? So that divide is blurring, and our systems are not really accommodating yet for that. As I said, it's baked into our regulation, our insurance, our reimbursement, all of that. Another very fascinating paradigm shift is parallelization. That's a term I made up, but medical logic usually proceeds in serial fashion. You do one test, you go to the next test, you do the third test, you know, you have a kind of step-by-step. And in the old days, in the established paradigm of medicine, that's the way you did it, especially if you're very scientific and analytic, and that's great. But now in digital healthcare, you have ambient sensors, ambient information from all over at the same time. So you have your wearable, you have your environmental sensors, you have your genetic data, everything coming together in parallel. So I call that parallelization. And the way doctors think and the way medical education is done is not really entirely fitting with that. We still have that serial process. And that's also manifest in the insurance and the regulatory. You don't just jump in and get an MRI, you need some other tests first. So you have this step by step. So I can't go through all the paradigm shift, but to summarize, I think digital healthcare is changing medicine in deeper ways. And in addition to, you know, the technologies, we need to think about how we can actually change the social structures and the legal structures to accommodate those changes.
Well, that's fantastic. And you mentioned technology itself is not always the focal point. And it's a fantastic message that you gave there about the blur around wellness and the medical side of things. And you mentioned the brands, and we have the example without naming, but Apple, for example, it sits on a broader line of wellness, but they still want to see being seen as a medical device. So I think it's this confusion as well for the,
right,
not just the industry, but for the consumer as such. Okay, I have an ECG on my wrist, on my phone, but it's not to be used as a medical diagnosis tool. But it is. It's
that's right.
I mean, is this contradiction, as you know, and you know better than me because you are a clinician. And
I'll give you a little anecdote, personal anecdote, just for a funny story. Yeah. So we were moving from South Korea to Canada. So we wanted to sell a bunch of stuff, and I had the extra blood pressure monitor. I tried to sell it on Facebook, and they said you can't sell it because it's a medical device.
Yeah.
Well, I'm, you know, just a regular person, albeit, you know, with a medical training, but you don't need a doctor's degree to take your blood pressure. It's hooked to my smartphone. So it was a cool device, not cheap. So I wanted to sell it. And that was very strange to me. And that actually links up to your first question. You know, all these digital healthcare technologies empowering the wellness side, but if our systems are still separate, it's going to be difficult. We need to somehow be able to blur that, not just in concept, but in reality.
Sure, breaking these barriers. I have one third and last question for you. You know, I'm a fan of your work and you've been doing great stuff. And the third and last question is, you are doing great work on the educational side. And can you tell us a bit more about your MiniMD program and your vision, please?
Sure. So the MiniMD is something that I've been teaching for about a decade now. And I, before the pandemic, used to teach it live, mostly in Asia, because I was based in South Korea, as I mentioned. So I taught it in South Korea, both in an industry as well as an academic setting, in Singapore several many times, in Australia, in New Zealand, in Philippines. And then also I did in the United States as well as Italy. And then, of course, when the pandemic broke, converted that to a virtual format. So I've been teaching that worldwide. So the MiniMD is a comprehensive, intensive 24-hour over 8 sessions, 3 hours a session, overview, but intensive overview of all of medicine, like in medical school. So it goes through the basic sciences, the clinical sciences, the medical specialties, surgery and surgical specialties, and of course the basic science, and pulls that all together. And the reason I did that is, there's a lot of healthcare professionals, in fact, every healthcare professional has the fundamental issue of how do we integrate with the clinical world? How do we bring the translational medicine on the biomedical side, or, you know, the EMRs and the digital healthcares? How do we make that easy for doctors, easy for patients? How does medicine work? How does the doctor's work, you know, mind work? And, you know, over 50% of digital healthcares fail, digital healthcare startups fail. And you might be familiar with Dr. Arlen Myers. He's a very prominent entrepreneur, and he's cited that some of the biggest reasons for that failure is not communicating with the doctors, not getting their needs, not integrating with the healthcare workflow. So I've developed that MiniMD. I present it around the world a couple times a year. The next session's coming up in January. And my future vision for the MiniMD is to actually make a more simplified version to address the gap that we mentioned in your first question. How do we make this for everyday people? So they have a little bit of the tools. How does the history, how does the physical work? How does diagnosis work? What are the different types of treatments, medicine versus surgery, all these sorts of things, which are kind of people vaguely know, but to be very clear. And then on the other side, I think it'll be very important to bring this to medical schools as a formal part of medical education. So medical education is outstanding, but ultimately it is fragmented. You know, you get your lecture from your cardiologist and you get your lecture from your gastroenterologist. And after 4 or 6 years of medical school, you get very good training. But this is a little secret. Doctors never get a bird's eye view of all of medicine during their medical education. And I think that's very necessary. So I'm also working on making the MiniMD on a professional level. And so patients complain about the fragmentation of healthcare. Oh, the doctor only knows about my liver. I bounce around doctors for the diagnosis. I go to the pulmonologist, I go to the cardiologist, et cetera. Well, that fragmentation is a necessary part of specialization, but at the same rate, it's a reflection of the educational process. So the MiniMD is now for professionals in healthcare, but I hope to bring it also to the general public as well as to medical students and medical professionals.
Okay, that's fantastic. Thank you so much for that. I mean, much needed also, for example, in here in UK, but around the world, we talk about closing the gaps, the digital skills, the technology, and then also you cover such a broad range there from the truly medicine side of things, the disease side. So it's truly needed for all of those involved. And for example, myself, I'm not a clinician, but I'm in healthcare and I'm interested in learning about at least a very good base knowledge. So before, I'm also going to put all the links so people can get in touch, and I hope everybody gets in touch with you to know more about this magnificent program. Ogan, I want to thank you for your time, for your expertise, for your magnificent contribution. But before I lead out the program, I finish all my episodes in a peculiar way. It's not a question as such. It's called 1 minute of fame. You can talk about anything. You have so many accomplishments. I know you already mentioned the MiniMD, but to round up, maybe 30 seconds or 1 minute, mention anything. It can be a personal achievement, professional achievement. It can be anything whatsoever. Over to you before I round up.
Sure. So ultimately, as a doctor, the most important part of medicine and the MiniMD or all my activities is the patient. And you know, helping people. And one of the most satisfying aspects, I mean, I've had many people, you know, say the MiniMD has helped them, and I've actually had people write back and they say, well, my knowledge actually helped in not only understanding my condition, and I'm not going to go into the details, of course, but actually improving the diagnosis. There was some, I wouldn't say misdiagnosis, but things that were missed. So with that knowledge, she went back to the doctors, asked more questions, and got it properly diagnosed. So these ways that we've impacted on patients and saved lives are the things that ultimately are the most motivating and the most satisfying.
Brilliant. What a way to finish. Ogan, thank you so much. Thank you for your amazing contribution. It's been a delight to have you here, and truly impactful work, and the last example, making a difference. So I'm going to post the links to connect with Ogan here, his LinkedIn, his Twitter, his website links. Make sure you ask him about his magnificent work. And to round up to our viewers and listeners, make sure you subscribe to the channel, share this magnificent content in healthcare, check our partners, and I'll see you all next week.